to our EPC commissioners and to guests of the assembly, grace and peace be yours in fullest measure through the knowledge of God and Jesus Christ our Lord. It is truly an honor to be with you all tonight, and this is day two, and I can truly say that it is a test of endurance. Amen. But as Michael has been saying for the last day and day and a half, that we are stronger together, so we will continue to endure by God's grace. I am so thankful as well to have my wife of 32 years, Ida Farrell, here. Yep. I mean, she is my rock in all of those differing things. And so I said, my wife of 32 years, and you all probably said, how old is this brother? But we are enjoying this season of being empty nesters, and we love that. And this is what happens when you get married at 12 and 13, and you stay together. And so we thank the Lord for that. So it was a Monday in February, and I'm doing what all pastors do on Mondays in February. I'm preparing for the following Sunday. And so I look down on my phone, and Dean Weaver. I'm like, oh man, this can go any kind of way. And the text said, hey brother, do you have 5 minutes? I have an ask, ASK. I said, hit me. And so shortly after that, he calls. And so he picks up the phone, and I pick up the phone, and we start exchanging pleasantries. And then he hit me with the ask, can you preach at GA on Wednesday night? At that time, my heart started beating so fast I could hear it through my ears. I started sweating so much, it was like I had a dead body in the house and the cops were knocking on the door. I mean, but obviously, I'm here, so I said yes. But my yes did not result in more nerves. It actually resulted in peace. You see, because as Dean continued to speak, he touched this burning desire in my heart that I've had as a church coordinator, as a pastor, and since joining the EPC, to see all churches in the EPC. It should be a burning desire in all of our hearts to see all of our churches in the EPC grow in becoming great commissioned churches, focused on making disciples to the glory of God. And so here I am, and trusting that this word tonight that God will enable me to preach will resonate in our hearts, that we will seek to do God's good and his perfect will in our lives. So as we prepare for our heart, prepare our hearts, let me read from Psalm 67, tonight's text. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would give us ears to hear tonight, that you would give us eyes to see, and that you would give us a heart to receive your word. And Lord, may we, with hands and feet, move tonight in obedience to what you command of us. So Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So each Lord's Day now, when we gather in our respective churches, we recognize that it is a gathering that is unlike any other, because it's the Lord Jesus who calls us into his presence, and we gather for covenant activity. We offer sacrifices of prayer, of praise, of thanksgiving, and we give of our tithes and our offerings to God. The word is preached, The sacraments are administered in their integrity. And before we depart, the Lord mediates his blessings to us, his people, by way of a benediction. So if we are ending our services with something like this, hey, it was great having you guys here tonight. Now go ahead and go out and have a great week, and we'll see you next week. Amen. Get out of here. If we're doing that, then we are missing a huge opportunity to remind the congregation that they have been blessed in order for them to go out and be a blessing. Our associate pastor, his name is Luke Callagher, a lifelong mentor of mine. And in our new members' classes, he never shrinks from exhorting those attendees that in many ways, the exit signs, they serve as some of the most important signs in our churches because they point us to our mission. In other words, the exit sign, they serve to remind us that we have received the mediated blessings of God in our hearts, and now we are going out, not for covenant activity. We are going out for mission activity. This is our call. And so what we want to do tonight is follow the lead of the psalmist in desiring the blessing of God in our hearts and in our minds, not as an end in itself, but for the sake of the nations. So this Hebrew word that's in our text today for blessing is none other than the word barak. It occurs over 400 times in Scripture, and half of those occurrences are in the first five books of the Bible, and 80 of those occurrences are in the Psalter. So we open up to the book of Genesis, and what do we see on that first page? Our Lord. He blesses the animals. Look down just a little few verses. He blesses our first parents. By the time we get to chapter 9, Noah and his sons, he blesses them as well. And all are told to be fruitful and multiply. And right there we see this life-infusing power of the word of God. Because God's word is an empowering word. It's not an empty expression of goodwill or gratitude. God's word has content. It actualizes, it enables. That which is blessed by God is divinely enabled to carry out its designated purpose in this world. And that is bringing glory to God. And this is the psalmist's desire. So we look here in verse 1, and the psalmist says this: may God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us. Selah. No doubt the psalmist is taken from Aaron's playbook. Look in Numbers 6 and remember how the story goes. The Lord comes to Moses, and Moses goes to Aaron. He says, this is what you shall say to Aaron and his sons when they bless my people. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you, and may he give you peace. And then the Lord says, you shall put my name on the children of Israel, the people of Israel, and I will bless them. So we have to ask the question, what does it mean for God's face to shine upon his people? Well, we know that our faces are real important, right? Because our faces express those varied emotions that we experience in all of life. So we think about our relationships that we have with our family, our friends, and our loved ones. What happens when they say something that brings us great joy? We turn our faces to them with an expression of said joy. But man, what happens when they disgust us? We turn our faces away in frustration. This should give us some idea, some theological insight of how the face of God is seen in Scripture. You see, when God turns his face toward us, it's an expression of joy at our obedience. Oh, this is blessing. But when God turns his face away, it's his displeasure. at our disobedience. Now we're talking about discipline. When God sets his face against sinners, his anger is kindled, and we're talking about judgment. But the one that we cannot overlook for the purposes of our discussion tonight is how the shining face of God suggests his presence with his people. Now we know that which is unholy cannot be in the holy presence of God apart from his gracious and merciful intervention in a person's life. And so the point is this: it's only through God's grace why his face shines upon his people. Only by God's grace his face shines upon his people. And so why is the psalmist praying for God's gracious presence to be with his people? Why is he praying for that? We look in verse 2 and the psalmist says, so that your way may be made known on earth, your saving power among all nations. And here's the broken record of this sermon. If we desire God's way to be made known on earth, his saving power among all nations, we must all have a burning desire in our hearts for God's face to shine upon us. If we rely on ingenuity or technique to carry forth the mission of God solely, we will surely fail. We see that methodology is useless apart from God's gracious intervention in our lives, dwelling in us and also among us. And the psalmist, he knows this. And as he continues in his prayer to God, he prays that everyone in the world will respond to God's great salvation with praise. Looking at verses 3 and 5, and this is what the psalmist says. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth. And if you didn't get it the first time, the psalmist says it again in verse 5. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. And so we ask the question, why is the psalmist so emphatic that everyone in the world should praise God? Because the psalmist knows the Lord's character. He knows that God is not some vengeful ruler stuck on pride and injustice. Rather, God is just and true in everything that he does. And like a shepherd, he gently leads his flock. Because he's merciful, he's gracious, he's slow to anger, and he is abounding in steadfast love. Brothers and sisters, the reign and the rule of God in our lives is not a reign and rule of terror. It is a reign and rule of joy. And the joy that we experience in our relationship with God has to overflow to the nations, causing them to be glad and sing out with said joy. You see, the psalmist knows that throughout redemptive history, God has led his people with justice and with equity. And he is absolutely certain that the Lord will do the same for those who would bow the knee in humble submission to his rule and also his reign. And the psalmist is also telling us this tonight, that this joy that comes from the gracious reign and rule of God is not just for Jews only. It's for every type of person in the world, no matter the skin tone, no matter the race, no matter the gender, the national origin, or the language. Every type of person in the world. So now we get to verses 6 and 7, and the psalmist is, he's ending his prayer. And he's not doing it on a somber note. He is doing it on a note of confidence, a high note, if you will. We look at verses 6 and 7. He says, the earth has yielded its increase. God, our God shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. Look at these two verses and we see just a wonderful example of how we are to remain confident in the blessings of God for the future based on God's faithfulness to us in the past and also in our present. Like, what is the psalmist saying? The earth has yielded its increase. Harvest has come. The fruits of our labor, they have been realized. God, our God, shall bless us. All of the blessings go to whom? The one from whom all blessings flow. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. Now for the broken record of the sermon. If we long for the ends of the earth to fear God, it starts with a burning desire in our hearts for God's face to shine upon us, specifically that the nations will see the blessings of God on his people and turn and praise the name of God as a result. Because we are a people who have been shaped by the gospel. And because we have been shaped by the gospel, we are now called to go out and witness this good news of God's saving grace to the nations. What does that mean then? It means that the EPC cannot exist for itself. Because if we did, we could be accused and be guilty of being an apathetic, spiritually lazy denomination that ignores the needs of the world. And we say to ourselves, Lord, may that never be. So when we go back to our respective churches now, we don't go back to sit on God's blessings. We don't go back to fatten up theologically and just chill. Because there is a harvest out there. And what we're told in scripture is that the harvest is truly plentiful. This is what Mark DeJay shared with us this morning. As he was doing it, I'm like, Mark, take it easy because you're getting real close to my sermon, my brother. So we think, we just think for a little while, Matthew 9. And I would like to think if Matthew 9, think for a second, is a day in the life of Jesus. It's a 24-hour period. It is a busy day in the life of our Lord and our Savior. Open up to Matthew 9, there's a paralytic. The Lord forgives his sins. And then, of course, he heals him. He leaves from there and he goes out and he calls Matthew, follow me, and Matthew follows him. Next thing you know, he's being accused of eating with sinners. There's a woman that's bleeding for 12 years, hemorrhaging. He heals her, turns around and raises Jairus' daughter from the dead, who happens to be 12 years old. Leaves from there, there are two blind men, heals them. There's a man who cannot speak, heals him as well. And if that's not enough, and then Matthew tells us he goes throughout the cities, the villages, he's preaching, he's teaching, and he's healing. He's getting close to the end of the day. He's having compassion on the people because they're like sheep without a shepherd. And he comes back to the disciples and he says, boys, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Pray to the Lord of the harvest that he will send out laborers into his harvest. And that is our call tonight. It is to pray to the Lord of the harvest that he will shine his face upon us so that we can go out and make his way known to everyone in the world whom he's calling to himself. So what does that look like then in the Evangelical Presbyterian Church in our denomination? We have to look no further than the vision that God has given to us as a denomination. Mike put this up in the plenary talk today in the effective biblical leadership portion. And I'll read the EPC's vision again. Our vision to the glory of God. The EPC family aspires to embody and proclaim Jesus' love as a global movement of congregations engaged together in God's mission through transformation, multiplication, and effective biblical leadership. This is the vision that God has given to this denomination to make his way known on earth, his saving power among the nations. Inside of that vision contains our four gospel priorities. And these gospel priorities, which we've already gotten through all four in day two of our summit, these four priorities must be alive and well in all of our EPC churches. Why? Because we are connected to one another, but not just in the name of Presbyterianism. We are connected together in the name of Jesus Christ. We are heirs and co-heirs with Christ. We are members of God's household. We are members of the body of Christ. And so we have gathered here for these 3 days to glorify God in our worship, in our fellowship, in our business, and to sharpen one another by uniting around these four priorities, gospel priorities, that the Lord has given to us. First thing we know is he's called us to be a global movement of congregations engaged together in his mission. We heard yesterday, this is world outreach, the global missions portion of the EPC, the arm of the EPC. We heard yesterday the concern, the cost, and also the culmination. Because the focus is on the hard-to-reach areas where few, if any, access to the gospel is had. The concern for the 3.2 billion unreached peoples and the 7,000 plus unreached people groups. We prayed for those scrolls together. The cost, suffering, and maybe death. The culmination, gospel ambition. You go to the World Outreach page, you'll be greeted with a quote from Habakkuk 2:14, and it should be our prayer and our earnest desire that one day the earth will be filled with the knowledge of God as the waters cover the sea. And so we join with Gabriel and the World Outreach crew that we earnestly yearn for the day when we see representatives from every tribe, tongue, and nation following Jesus and worshiping around God's throne. We're called to pursue transformation. This speaks to church health, church revitalization. The language that we use is when a church is in incline. The only way to go after that is in decline. But through church revitalization, you launch another season of incline and you refocus on becoming a Great Commission church. That also includes identifying and training transitional pastors. What's pivotal in churches is when they're in transition without a pastor, identifying training transitional pastors to help churches refocus on the Great Commission as they ready themselves to call their next pastor. And transformation also includes reigniting this passion for evangelism because we cannot afford to rely on transfer growth. Having the conversations with pastors after the pandemic, our church actually grew during the pandemic. Was that conversions or were that transfers? The highest priority must be placed on conversion growth through gospel witness. And when this is alive and well in a church, the church now has been transformed to a mission outpost. dedicated to kingdom and gospel activity. And every member in the church sees themselves as a missionary in God's field. We're called to pursue multiplication, kingdom-mindedness over castle-mindedness. That's what we heard. Developing a culture, cultivating a culture where church planting is embraced, encouraged, and celebrated. Every church in the EPC participating as a parent, a partner, or a patron, a parent planting churches, a partner coming alongside those who are planting churches, a patron, a serial patron, continuing to resource those who are planting churches. Tom Ricks even said here that we ought to pray for the next generation of church planters, whomever the Lord is calling to that work. And he gave an age demographic as well. I think he said from 32 to 42. I know I'm out of that age demographic, but there's a lot that still can be done. And we join with Tom Ricks and his crew. And we know that God has made a promise to us. Christ has said he is the one who builds his church. And the gates of hell will not prevail. We're called to pursue effective biblical leadership. And we found out today, to be effective leaders, we cannot be angry pastors walking into churches preaching a gospel of love. We should be full of love. Therefore, we can preach this gospel of love. Self-care, self-awareness. We choose self-care over self-medication. There's a leadership development culture that is cultivated, characterized by disciples, making disciples, get the point? Who continue to make disciples. Think of those successful NFL coaching trees where successful coaches spawn more coaches and more coaches who go on to achieve a measure of success in the NFL. So what does that look like for us? Leaders not resting on their laurels, continuing to grow in our leadership as we train and mentor the next generation of leaders who will carry forth and build on this mission and this vision that God has given to us as a denomination. I stand here not by myself, but as a byproduct of effective biblical leadership spanning many, many years. And so, like, why do we do this then? Why are we here? It's because the blessing of God has already come to us in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Through his sinless life, his death, his burial, and his resurrection, his glorious resurrection from the dead, all the promises of God have been fulfilled and yet to be fulfilled in our Lord and Savior. Because we know that there is coming a day when every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. But while we continue to wait for our Lord's return, or when he calls us home, we continue to proclaim this good news of the gospel that still has the power to save souls, because our Lord is still in the business of revealing himself to those who are lost in this broken, in this anxiety-ridden world. And like, how humbling is it to know that he uses us, and he doesn't leave us to ourselves. He's given us his word. He's given us his Holy Spirit. He's given us each other, stronger together. And he's given us a testimony. It makes us instruments in our divine master's hands. And he says that he will never leave us, nor will he ever forsake us, but he will be with us until the end of the age. So may we be found faithful tonight in doing God's good and perfect will in this world as we live for the world to come. And may God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us so that his way may be known on earth, his saving power among all nations. Amen.